Hi, everybody. Welcome to our second episode in our webinar series, Teaching Business for People and Planet, where we attempt to discuss the future of business and the teaching of business and how they can influence society in a good way, sustainable for the planet and meaningful for its people. And that has really never been more important than it is now in the wake of the Glasgow Climate Change Conference, where it was mainly left to businesses to learn to pivot and change their business models from a linear to a more circular way of thinking. My name is Lucia Sweet. I'm a marketing manager at Sage and your webinar host for today. And each episode of the webinar, we will interview one of our many inspiring authors that work with Sage. And we usually approach a very relevant topic around sustainability or responsible management teaching in the business school. Today, we have our wonderful guest, Sage author, Debbie Haski-Leventhal. She's Professor of Management at Macquarie Business School and an expert on corporate social responsibility, responsible management education, and volunteerism, and author of Strategic Corporate Social Responsibility. Just a bit of admin at the beginning. This is recorded and will be live streamed on YouTube. And the recording will also be available to you in an email that we will send in the next few days, with lots of important information about how to order things and contact details. So do look out for the email. There will also be a Twitter feed. We're using the hashtag Teaching Business for People and Planet. So do join the conversation there. We will live tweet. So yes, please join. And there will also be time for a Q&A section at the end. So add your questions in the Q&A and we'll sort of filter them to the author. That's it for me. I'm going to leave it to Matt Waters, who is publisher at Sage and has kindly agreed to run this interview for us.
Thanks, Lucia. So good morning, afternoon, evening from wherever you join us today. Welcome to the second instalment of our webinar series, Teaching Business for People and Planet. Today, we are talking about CSR and where CSR finds itself today, both in industry and in business education. I'm one of the editors at Sage, and I've had the pleasure of working with Debbie now on three occasions, once on an edited book about employee engagement in CSR, once on the first edition of Debbie's CSR student textbook, and now on the updated second edition of Debbie's CSR textbook, which you can see behind Debbie and has just published. So Debbie, I wanted to start by asking you, it's been 5 years since we first met in Sydney to discuss CSR in relation to your then two book proposals, now books for Sage. We've since seen a growing interest in social issues within culture and internal organizations around CSR. And I'm thinking of recent social movements such as Black Lives Matter, Extinction Rebellion, and the transgender rights movement, and how they've impacted on organizations over the past few years, as well as the growing uptake of the UN's sustainable development goals within both public and private sectors, including, of course, within business schools. So the first question for you is, where do you think CSR finds itself today within that milieu, 5 years on from when we had our very first conversation within industry and in turn the business school?
Thanks, Matt. Great to be here. I can't believe it's been 5 years since we had this meeting in Sydney so many years ago. And the world has changed a lot. Business has changed a lot and business education has changed a lot. And I would say that the biggest change is in the mindset. And what I see is that the idea of CSR as a marketing, PR, reporting tool is no longer as valid as it was 5 years ago. And what many businesses now understand is that CSR is not a department, a role, an officer or report, it's a mindset. And some people confuse CSR with corporate philanthropy or even things like employee volunteering, but it is about the holistic approach to responsibility. And so the biggest change is that an increasing number of businesses are taking a more holistic and strategic approach, if you like, with it, hence the title, Strategic CSR. And what it actually means is that you take a more proactive approach to responsibility. So if I asked you, Matt, if you are a responsible person, you wouldn't answer, yes, I give some money to charity. Instead, you would try to show me how you live your life in a way that causes no harm, that you live in a way that's responsible, safe, taking care of the people that you are responsible of, et cetera, et cetera. And so businesses now come to realize that CSR is about responsibility and that we need a more holistic and strategic approach. So what we've seen is maybe a shift from a reactive approach where CSR was done to maybe patch some negative actions in the business to a more proactive approach, and now to a real active approach with activism. And maybe we'll talk about it later today, through corporate political activism, climate activism, businesses are now looking to see how they can shift away from an internal look into the way that they manage their business responsibly to a more external look on how they can influence other stakeholders, including the government. And we've seen it very strongly with COP26, the climate summit in Glasgow, where companies actually pushed the heads of states and the policymakers to make a commitment and to adhere to this commitment in the summit and, of course, afterwards.
So something that really strikes me is CSR has become intermingled as a term with other key concepts such as business ethics, responsibility, sustainability, which you mentioned, social purpose, and so on. Mm-hmm. And I think this is maybe why we continue to hear of the death or talk around the death or the rebirth of CSR, because it now exists within this quite complicated ecosystem, if you like, of related concepts and practices. So where do you situate CSR within this kind of glossary or toolbox of related terms, and what is the value exactly of its ongoing usage?
If you take the holistic approach to CSR, as I do in the book, then all of these things come under the umbrella of CSR. Because if it is about a holistic and strategic responsibility of the business, it also encompass the ethical behaviors, so doing the right thing. It includes things like environmental sustainability, environmental responsibility. It includes the way that businesses interact with their stakeholders, internal and external stakeholders. So I think that if you understand CSR the way that I approach it in a more holistic and strategic way, then all of these is included under CSR. Purpose is a little bit more interesting, because CSR could serve as the purpose of business, as the why we do what we do. We do what we do to utilize our resources, our power, our voice, and contribute to the community, to society, to help achieve the sustainable development goals and so on. But it could be also another way in which the organization achieves its greater purpose. And we are seeing a shift towards purpose-driven organizations, where now companies and other kinds of organizations are stating what is their why, what is their purpose, what is this that they meant to do. And it's never about maximizing profit, because it is the result. It's not the purpose of doing what you do. And it's interesting to see more and more companies using purpose, even in their marketing, in their PR, in the way they talk about their brand. And CSR can play a very important role in the way that we discover our purpose, communicate it, and then live by it, embedded in every part of the organization, so all our stakeholders know what our purpose is and help us achieve it.
Great, thank you. So in the new edition of your textbook and in your employee engagement edited book, as well as actually in the recent MIT Sloan Management Review publications that you've had out, you cover these new topics in relation to CSR, such as, which you already mentioned, the rise of kind of so-called CEO activism, corporate activism in relation to social issues of the day, and also social intrapreneurship, mm-hmm. which is now taking place within organizations. So could you say a little bit about these kind of new emerging topics and again, how they interconnect with CSR?
I feel very lucky to be in a place where I can be exposed to all these exciting and innovative things taking place in businesses. And I would like to talk for a few minutes about two of these trends, so corporate political activism and social entrepreneurship. And corporate political activism and climate activism, as we've covered in some of our articles, is a way in which companies are using their voice, their agency, their platforms to stand up and speak up about things that really matter. And it's interesting that it so happened that there is a huge increase in corporate political activism, or there was, in the era of Donald Trump, because so many companies have started feeling that they can no longer be silent. And whereas maybe 10 years ago, there was a separation, there is business and there is politics and we shouldn't mix the two. It started with CEO activism, where prominent CEOs use their platforms and voice to talk about things that matter to them. But then we see actually companies using their own brand to talk about issues such as racism, Black Lives Matter, LGBTQI plus rights, and so on. And I touch on that in the second edition of the book, which I feel very grateful that I had the opportunity to actually update the book and get all these new trends into the book. And so we see, for example, Ben and Jerry's tweeting just in the days where they were still counting the votes for the elections in the US a year ago, my goodness. And Ben and Jerry said, "We can't believe an ice cream company needs to say it, but voters have voted and we need to wait for the votes to be counted." And what Donald Trump is doing is undermining democracy. 10 years ago, we wouldn't have even thought that it was possible for companies to stand up and speak about political issues under their brand. And that's a very exciting development, because we now see that it's not about what I do with my stakeholders. It's not about the way that I manage waste and so on and so on. It's about a mindset. It's about living by the values of the company and standing by what matters. And it's also another way of involving employees, which is, again, very, very important, because the best socially responsible companies in the world don't do it alone. They work with all their stakeholders, especially with their employees, and they give them the platform to lead the change that they want to see in the world. And with that, we can see the rise of social intrapreneurship. So intrapreneurship, unlike entrepreneurship, happens within the organization. So while I'm still being employed by a company, a not-for-profit, a social enterprise, I can come with innovative solutions. And that, if it's a business entrepreneurship, we're talking about innovative solutions to products and services. But if we're talking about social entrepreneurship, I'm talking about how we use our creative thinking to come up with solutions to environmental and social problems. So things like in Optus, one of the big telecom companies in Australia, which is featured as a case study in the book together with Singtel, a Singaporean company, there was one employee who saw that a lot of homeless people used to buy the $2 per day plan. And then he went up to the company and says, "Why don't we actually come up with a solution to people struggling with homelessness? Give them the $2 plan, but then also have things like free calls to social services." So this is one employee being at the front of the company, seeing social issues and other issues that maybe people at the top cannot see, and then coming up with innovative solutions that could truly change the company, but also help society at large.
On the eve of the recent COP26 climate summit in Glasgow, Greta Thunberg, in a widely shared speech, said that the time for talking about climate emergency had kind of passed, and what we need instead is decisive action. She referred to it as blah, blah, blah. And this really reminded me of something you've always said about CSR, which is that talk is cheap, and that instead of using CSR as branding or a mode of corporate communications, what's really needed is for CSR to be fully baked into the business model and pertain to every aspect of the organization, what it does, what it stands for. And you refer to this as fostering a what you call a holistic approach. So could you tell us a bit more about this holistic approach? And also, I'd be really interested to hear about how you integrate such a holistic approach into your teaching of CSR with your students.
Excellent. Yeah, the time for blah, blah is over. There's just no more time. We can't spare any more. You know, we can't afford another decade of inaction. We can't afford another decade of pollution and waste and continuing with business as usual. It's just no longer an option. What we're doing now is so irresponsible. And although we are seeing a shift and many companies are taking a different approach to creating amazing solutions, not just for themselves, but for everyone else. And one of the cases in the book is about Google, and it's not a perfect company. I'm not interested in saints, but I think it would be really interesting to see what they're doing and the way they now generate renewable energy, not just for themselves, which is important because Google actually uses the same energy as a small country, but to help 1 billion people use renewable energy by a certain time. So we really need some courageous actions. We need to see companies shift the way they think about the environment from an open sewer to a large rubbish bin to something that we really ought to cherish and make sure that it is something that we and our children can live at. Because as I continuously say in the book, the planet will survive. It's just going to change so much that we'll no longer be able to survive within it. And so I have to tell you, Matt, that writing the two editions of the book, when I wrote chapter 5, which is now chapter 6 in the new edition about environmental sustainability, I was so depressed because the first edition of the book, I looked at some of the things that are happening around the world and I read a lot about palm oil and the damages that it does. And reading about all these animals that are almost extinct, and then going to the second edition, and I checked all the updates and things have gone a lot worse. We really need to see a very, very fast turnaround. We just can't afford another even 5 years of blah, blah, as Greta Thunberg is saying that. And that's something that I try to communicate with my students as I teach CSR. Look, I define my life purpose as using my teaching and my research to create a positive impact in the world. And I will never be a CEO of a big company. My career, you know, I'm not going to change my career path by now, but some of my students might be. And so I feel like this huge privilege, as well as the responsibility to make sure that in the very limited time I've got with them, I want to embed a new way of thinking in future business leaders. And I see that time after time in the way that we talk about these issues with a lot of responsibility, but also a lot of passion and empathy and care, that the students really do change the way that they think about these issues. And some of them do end up in very powerful positions and are able to change the direction of the organizations which they lead. And so it's an important way for me to do that. And because I always preach for a multi-stakeholder approach, and I always say that businesses should reach out, I try to do that in my teaching as well. And so I actually get my students. Before COVID, I just used to put them all on a bus and go and tour companies and see the good things that they're doing. As I say, I don't know a perfect company, but I know a lot of companies where we can learn some good things from. And that's my approach in the book, and that's my approach in my teaching. And I try to, based on positive psychology, utilize the best examples that I can find. And I also do that in the book, to inspire other people to try and find creative ways to leave a more positive footprint behind.
When you were saying there about the students on the bus, it made me think one thing that always struck me about your textbook is, and what was appealing about it from a publisher's perspective, is that it was based on your course and that you'd been teaching this course for many years. So in effect, you'd been kind of road testing this content with students over a number of years. Could you say a bit about how you've taught CSR and kind of what content coverage and teaching methods have worked best and what you think students have responded to most in your teaching of CSR?
As I say in the introduction of the book, this book came to me because of a bit of a frustration, which I shared with you 5 years ago when we met, because having looked at many textbooks of CSR, and some of them are great, but I couldn't find one that combined theories with tools. And that's what I really wanted to have. I wanted to have all these frameworks and ideas and concepts together with tools that students can take and implement in their workplace tomorrow. So it was very important to tie things like ideas around what CSR is, what is the philosophy behind business ethics, but also to provide them with actual tools on how to solve ethical dilemmas and how to report on their CSR. And the second edition has even more tools than the first one had. And so it's about having a toolkit that the students can go and use and implement. So it gives them some sort of a blueprint or a roadmap to how to become a more responsible business. And that's also what I try to do when I teach. And I don't see myself, my teaching philosophy is that I don't see myself as a teacher or a lecturer standing in front of students. I'm an enabler of shared learning. All I need to do is to facilitate the amazing discussion that comes up from the experienced students and everything that they bring with them to the classroom to have this remarkable learning experience, something that would create a sense of meaningfulness for me and for the students. And so I really do love teaching. And I was very privileged that this year my CSR students actually nominated me to the Vice Chancellor Teaching Award. And in 12 days, I'll find out if I received the award. But it was just very moving to see that the students themselves thought that, we want to do something. And every time I teach CSR, I've got students putting together a petition to the dean that this unit needs to be a core unit, a mandatory unit. And I see an increasing number of business schools now changing the way that businesses are changing, taking a more holistic approach to CSR. So it's not just an elective or even one core unit, but CSR, responsibility and sustainability are embedded in the whole curriculum. And so we have to make sure that MBA students and business graduates, when they finish their journey with us, they come out on the other side with a lot more responsibility and a sustainable mindset.
Great, thank you. So could you talk us through the book a little bit, just briefly, what you cover in the book and what's new specifically to this edition? Mm-hmm. And also, I think, one real plus of the book is the case studies. You have some super engaging case studies in there. So could you say a bit about those as well?
Sure. Again, I really enjoyed working on the second edition. There are not many opportunities in life to fix something you did in the past. And so to be able to look again at the first book, which was not bad, but to have the opportunity to really rethink of what I want to say and how I want to say, I've learned so much between the two editions. And I really wanted to share that learning with everyone who is going to read the book. And there is also a lot of changes that happen, a lot of trends that occurred, and I wanted to cover them. And so the book looks at things that we've already mentioned, like corporate social, corporate political activism, social intrapreneurship. It also looks at changes such as CSR in India, CSR in China, CSR reporting in China. And so it looks at other countries. It becomes more holistic or global in the way that I cover cases and examples from countries such as Egypt, Singapore, India, and many others. And I really like the idea of having an opening case study to illustrate each chapter of the book, We also have a new chapter, chapter 5 now, which looks at the social responsibility. And so if it's a book about corporate social responsibility, we felt together that we should probably cover the social separately. And so we looked at what it means to, for example, build a community, what it means to work with all your external and internal stakeholders, what it means to be a business as a force for good. And there are a lot of case studies, new case studies in the second edition, such as Infosys from India and Patagonia and Whole Foods Markets from the US. Some of the old cases are there too, which I've updated. But one of my favorite new cases is Tony Chocolonely. It's a chocolate company from the Netherlands. And the reason I like it is because they were not established to sell chocolate. They sell chocolate. They're actually the number one chocolate selling company in the Netherlands and in some European countries. But they're actually not established to sell chocolate. They were established to raise awareness of modern slavery and what we should know about it. So every time we eat chocolate that's not completely fair trade, we are contributing to child labor and modern slavery, because most of the cocoa beans in the world are harvested by slaves and children. And so what they've done is they sell this really good chocolate. It's fantastic. I've tasted every time I go to the Netherlands. But if you take their chocolate bar and you open it in the wrap, there is so much information about modern slavery. If you go on their website, it's not about flavors and the hazelnut chocolate. It's about how we can do something about this issue. And they are committed to 100% slave-free chocolate. And the best bit is that each chocolate bar is not equally divided, to remind us that we still don't have equality in the world. And each piece is different. And some of the pieces in each chocolate bar actually are based on the shape of the countries in Africa from which chocolate arrives. And so what we see is the power of businesses utilizing the amazing impact that businesses can have to raise awareness of social issues, environmental issues, and using their products and their brand to really change the way that we behave globally and publicly.
Great, thank you. I'm conscious of time, and there's some questions popping up in the chat. So I think now would be a good time to bring in some questions. And there are a couple of really nice questions in the chat there. So the first one is, and thank you for this, whoever posted it. How do we resolve the lack of carbon credit to encourage businesses to invest in CSR?
Sorry, I'm just reading it. So there are two ways to approach it. One is to start the revolution bottom up. So even if governments are not going to do what needs to be done to make sure that businesses are conducted responsibly, businesses can still take action. When Donald Trump withdrew from the Paris Agreement, actually a lot of businesses said, we are still going to respect our commitments to reduce carbon emissions. And they set up a protest to say, you know, Google and other companies, we are still committed to the Paris Agreement, even if our president isn't. The other thing is to influence through lobby and advocacy, influence, we do have companies that are doing it. They're actually pushing for carbon tax laws and so on. And we had one in Australia. We had a carbon tax, and it was deleted when the next government came in. And so it's very important for companies not to wait for the government to tax them, but to really try and change things bottom up. Obviously, it will be best if things work in the same, you know, in the same direction, bottom up and top down. And so we see that through lobbying and advocacy, that we used to see only companies that are against climate action, such as the large oil and petroleum companies pushing against climate action. Now we see companies actually spending time, money, and effort on lobbying and advocating for carbon emission tax. And that's an interesting change that we see now.
Great, thank you for that. Another really good question, and please do keep them coming in the Q&A box. How do we encourage smaller non-listed businesses to engage in CSR and reporting for CSR?
That's a great question. And I really try to cover that in the second edition of the book. And I speak a lot more about small and medium size enterprise or SMEs in the book. There are different sections where I talk about, for example, CSR reporting in SMEs and give a lot more examples of SMEs. Obviously, some small organizations find it very difficult to start because they don't have the large budget, they don't have a CSR officer, but it doesn't mean that you can't work to use the power of your small business as a force for good. We in fact see a lot of small businesses starting as a social enterprise now and think about how I can utilize my small business, the items that I sell and so on to create a positive difference in the world. How can I be as sustainable in my small supply chain to make sure that I do not harm the environment, humans or animals? And that's quite refreshing. I was actually used to teach social entrepreneurship. And I used to have MBA students coming to my class because they wanted to start a regular business. But I was teaching them social entrepreneurship. So they said, what the heck, we'll just go to Debbie's class. And in the end, they said it makes so much more sense to start a social enterprise than a business enterprise because you get the benefits of all worlds. And so it's there is a huge opportunity for small companies to become or start as a social enterprise, thinking how can I actually leverage my products, my services, my small company to work with others and address social and environmental issues. And when you do that, you actually expose yourself to a whole range of opportunities, such as impact investors. Again, it's a new issue covered in the second edition about impact investing, and impact investors could be interested in your social enterprise and support it financially and in other ways.
Great, thank you. Somebody was asking for an inspection copy of the book. Absolutely, we can follow up with you on that. Thanks for that message. I had a question around the UN Sustainable Development Goals, because when I look around at business schools now, I just see that they're such a big part of what schools are doing, and they've been integrated into teaching, and you've got them there in the new edition. So there's 17 of them, and then how do you go about kind of bringing them into your teaching? How do you do that? What does that look like? And I would say, to avoid it kind of being a tick box kind of exercise, if you like how do you make it meaningful?
Absolutely. Look, there are only 3,000 days left to achieve the SDGs. That's not a lot. It will come, 2030 will come around very quickly. And we've seen some of the achievements towards some of these SDGs, such as poverty and hunger and health, so SDG 1, 2, and 3. We've actually seen some of these issues getting worse because of COVID-19. And so actually a lot of the achievements today were kind of erased by COVID, and we have to start again from scratch and to make sure that we do not leave anyone behind. And so what we can do as a business school is two things. One is work with businesses and encourage businesses to help achieve the SDGs. I always say help achieve, because no one can achieve it alone, not a government, not even a huge multinational company, but to help achieve it together is what we need to do. We need to really set goals now on how we're going to approach it. The second thing that we can do as a business school is to teach about the SDGs. When I've started teaching CSR, not a lot of students have heard about the SDGs, but now when students come to my class, probably about half of them know already about the SDGs, and by the time they finish with me, they know a lot about the SDGs. We've seen ranking bodies such as Times of Higher Education moving into their impact ranking, looking at how universities and business schools are utilizing their curriculum and their teaching facilities to teach about and work towards the SDGs. We've seen accreditation bodies such as AACSB now pushing business schools to work more towards the SDGs and teach about that. And of course, we have research capabilities of people teaching in business schools and universities. And it's very, very important that we use our research capabilities to collect data, inform policymakers and decision makers about where we stand with these issues and what kind of innovative solutions can we find to help address all 17. SDG 17 actually is about partnerships for the goals. And so it's very important that universities will partner with businesses, governments, not-for-profits, and all other stakeholders to jointly achieve these goals.
I suppose connected to the development goals is PRIME and their role within business schools, principles of responsible management education initiative that sits within the United Nations. So I know you've been very much involved with that group, and we're big fans here at Sage of what they do and their work. So could you say a bit about that and how you found your experiences with PRIME and what that's kind of, how that's kind of changed your teaching?
I think PRIME is such an important initiative. It came from the UN Global Compact, and the Global Compact was established in the year 2000 because we've seen so many problems and ethical scandals just before that. And there was an idea that we need to have a collaboration, a compact with the business world to achieve the goals, the Millennium Development Goals, and then the Sustainable Development Goals together. And in 2007, PRIME have started because it was also seen that there is a huge role to business education in making sure that we do not end up with MBA and other business graduates who then lead their organization into the ethical scandals such as Enron and WorldCom and so on. And so PRIME has started with the Principles for Responsible Management Education in order to help get business schools more involved with the UN and with the Sustainable Development Goals. When I joined Macquarie University in the year 2011, I've met the head of PRIME at the time, Jonas, and I suggested that we run together a large global survey around business students around the world and ask them what they think about CSR, responsible management education, sustainability, sustainable development goals, and so on. And we ran together the study four times over about a decade. So from 2011 to 2018, we ran the survey four times. And there were a lot of very positive results that came. So to date, we had over 10,000 students who answered the survey. And there are two things that really impressed me, and I cover them both in the book. The first one is when I ask students to rank business responsibility. So we probably all know about Archie Carroll's pyramid from 1979 and later 1991, where he sort of did a pyramid of business responsibilities with economic first, followed by legal, then ethical, and at the top, philanthropic. And although Archie Carroll said that, you know, businesses have to achieve all four, the fact that it was portrayed in a pyramid kind of signal a priority towards economic responsibility. And so I asked the students to rank the business responsibilities, and time after time, four times, the students say the most important responsibility of the business is ethical, followed by legal, only then financial, and then environmental, social, and philanthropic. And that's quite refreshing to see the next generation of business leaders reframing the responsibility of business. The other thing that really, I have to say, shocked me and surprised me was when I asked students, how much are you willing to forego of your future salary to work for an employer who is responsible. And then we had four categories. We said towards the employees, towards the environment, towards the community, other stakeholders. And then number five was an employer that encompasses all these four responsibilities. And I put a table and I said, you know, 0%, 1 to 10, and so on. And in the end, I put 40% of your future salary or more. And I just put it there because I thought no one is going to answer that much. No one is going to be willing to sacrifice that much of their future salary, and I'll have a nice bell curve. But to my shock and surprise, one in five students, and that's business students, not social work students, one in five students actually said they're willing to forego over 40% of their salary to work for an employer that exhibits all four responsibilities. In other words, one that's holistically responsible. And that is very encouraging because it's a very strong signal that these students are sending their future employers, and also us as their educational institution. And I think that's kind of encourages me to continue doing the work that I do and develop or sort of provide students with the tools and knowledge they need to find such purpose-driven organizations, responsible organization. And if they can't, then start the revolution bottom up and get your employer to be the responsible employer that you want them to be.
Great, thank you. We're getting some questions through on YouTube as well and some comments, so thank you for those. There's one that mentioning that CSR should not only cover the environment, it should cover the entire social spectrum. Yes, I think we would absolutely agree with that. And some also some questions here from Fred also on YouTube. He's asking about smaller businesses and the role of bigger companies working with or through smaller local businesses in terms of CSR.
Before I answer that, someone asked about this study of Prime and where you can find it. So on the UN Prime website, there are the reports of each of these studies that I've done. But also if you look through the Journal of Business Ethics, you can find two articles that I've published on this study. And it's also mentioned somewhat in the book. And so to your question, how can big businesses work with local businesses in order to achieve this? This is such an important question. And some of it is actually covered in the cases of the book. For example, I've mentioned Optus, which is the Australian telecommunication giant. And they work with small emerging businesses, helping them to become more sustainable and responsible. And they have, they actually have a program called Tomorrow Leaders or something along these lines, where they sponsor business leaders and social entrepreneurs who actually want to start a business as a force for good. We see a lot of businesses who already have B2B or business to business services utilize these platforms, even supply chains, working with suppliers or local businesses to make sure that they become more sustainable, that they have the power and the tools to become part of the movement of CSR. And so, for example, HP delivers these tools to every business that wants to become more sustainable. The National Australian Bank delivers online free tools for companies that want to start employee volunteering and not, you know, they're not sure how to start. So there are all these remarkable B2B kind of support from large businesses to smaller businesses, which can help fuel the movement.
Okay, there's a question from Magdalena in the Q&A. Saying, you know, let's go beyond just the SDGs and think about social impact. Do you have any idea of how to measure the social impact of companies?
Great question. Funny enough, we have a whole chapter in the book on measuring, communicating, and sharing social impact. And the example, the opening case study of that chapter is Thank You, which is an Australian company that was established to create social impact. They started as a water company to address the issue of 900 million people not having access to clean water. And they moved into body care and other products because, as Simon Sinek says, people don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it. And so because they're able to communicate their why and their impact so well, people are willing to buy anything from them. And an interesting way in which they do that is on each of their products, they have track your impact code. And you can actually take this code, go online, enter the code, and then you see where you created a positive impact. The whole idea of CSR is that it's there to create positive impact beyond what businesses are already doing through creating products that we may need or hiring people, giving them jobs and livelihood. How can we move beyond that, create positive impact in society, in the community in which we operate, and the global community as well? And so the book talks about what impact is, how can we contribute to people's quality of life, how can we measure that, how can we communicate that, and how can we engage all our stakeholders, not only in our own impact, but thinking about their own impact and how we can help increase that positive impact in the world.
Would you like to just say something quickly about the online resources as well that come with the book? Because we haven't mentioned those yet, and there's a lot of useful resources there for educators that would be worth flag in for the audience.
Absolutely. So with the second edition, we also provide a great toolbox of online tools that you can use teaching with this book. So if you are a CSR teacher and you subscribe to this book, you get access to presentations and slides, which you can use to go with the book. There are instructor manual from the syllabus that you can build, things like additional links, videos, discussions around each of the videos that we are linking to, additional questions for the students and class discussions, exercises, and even questions for exams and assignments, which you can use to work with the book. I think it's great, you know, if you start teaching CSR the way that I was maybe 12 years ago, and you feel a little bit lost because there is so much knowledge around it now, that you get all these online tools and you're able to almost hit the ground running. You still have to read it, but then you can just use it and facilitate these exercises, class discussions, and so on. And of course, this is just a starting point. You can use your creative juices to make it your own and use the slides in a way that works for you. But it's all available for free for people who subscribe to the book.
Great, thank you. I'm conscious that we're coming up to time. So was there any other kind of final or closing points that you would like to make about CSR in general, Debbie, or indeed the book?
When is the third edition coming out? No, I'm just really, really happy that we were able to work together and create a much updated, a little bit bigger book that touches on all issues around sustainability and responsibility. Again, trying to make it not just theoretical, although as Kurt Lewin once said, there's nothing as practical as a good theory, but also very applicable, great tools, things that you can take now and implement today. And I'm just really grateful for the whole team at Sage, to you, Matt, and to everyone I work with that helped me create that book. And I really hope it will help create a positive impact that I aim to do.
Absolutely, yeah. So pass over to you now, Lucia, for closing points around how to go around ordering an inspection copy of the book and any other closing comments.
Yeah, firstly, I just want to say thank you so much, Debbie, for agreeing to be our guest and for such a captivating discussion around approaching corporate social responsibility from a holistic point. And we also really liked your enthusiasm around teaching CSR, and we do hope you win the award for the best teacher in a couple of weeks. But thank you very much. And thank you, Matt, for facilitating the interview. And thank you all for signing up and asking very good questions in the chat, on YouTube, and on Twitter as well. And as I said at the beginning, check your inbox in the next couple of days. You will have an email with the recording of the webinar and information on how to order a copy of the book that we were talking about, so Strategic Corporate Social Responsibility. I have posted the links into the chat, and I've posted my email in the chat as well if you want to get in touch directly for any sort of comments or suggestions for our next webinar series. You can continue to get in touch on Twitter as well. And also just to say, don't forget about our series, Teaching Business for People and Planet. We aim to have an episode once a quarter on different themes with different authors. So continue to sign up for those, and we'll hopefully see you there. But it's been a lovely morning or evening talking about CSR. So thank you, everyone, and have a good day. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Debbie.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye.